collected as an oral history and will be part of the Chronicle Project, a project led by VCS Cymru and funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund. If you'd introduce yourself now.
Okay, my name is John Lomond. I am the volunteer coordinator at ACE Cardiff, which stands for All Communities Engaged. We're a charity in Bute Town that works with children in learning clubs, as well as a couple of other projects, but that is the main one with which I'm involved.
Could you tell us a bit more about this project?
So it started about 7 years ago because parents in the Bute Town area kind of needed some support with their children who were kind of falling a bit behind in school. We set up some homework clubs initially with the director trying to teach the children, but he realised himself that he wasn't very good at doing it. So we brought in a bunch of volunteers. Initially they came from It was one of the universities, University of South Wales, I think. And basically they took over the role of teaching the children.
And so how many of these clubs are there a week?
We have about 3 sessions per week. It's a bit tricky because initially we have about 3 sessions per week that are organised directly by us. But then we've recently made a partnership with Cardiff Sixth Form College, and they support us by getting involved in various other homework clubs with which we have a partnership, I guess. So in total it could be about 7 or 8 of them around the sort of Bute Town, Riverside and Grange Town area.
And what motivated you personally to get involved with the project?
To be honest with you, it was when I was volunteering initially. I was looking for some experience in office environment. That sounds really boring, but I hadn't really got much experience with that kind of admin area. It's kind of something to show on my CV that I'd got office experience. Obviously that sounds a bit cynical to begin with, but you know, I like the fact that it was a charity. I like the fact that they were supporting children with education, because I think that's a great thing for people who are, you know, not otherwise able to get the support they need. It began in a bit of a kind of self-beneficial way, but obviously that is often the case with volunteering, which I've since learned in my role now. But I soon grew to really appreciate the work that we were doing, going along to the learning clubs. I didn't initially go along to them a lot myself, but when I did, I saw like the work that the volunteers were doing, and it was really making a difference. So
in your role, you come into contact with lots of volunteers. Do they all have different motivations for getting involved with the project?
Yeah, the motivations for the volunteers are quite varied. You do kind of find sort of little pockets of categories which are like people will often fit into. So for example, because we're running learning clubs and there's a chance to teach, you'll often get people who are looking for teaching experience. So students who don't really know what they want to do once they graduate come along and get some experience in case they want to go into teaching. But we'll often get people who are retired, looking for something to give back. We've got a couple of retired teachers on our volunteering staff, and they want to do something with their time but also use the experience they have. But then you often find, which, you know, I don't have a preference necessarily, anyone who wants to volunteer is great, but you often kind of get people who don't really do it for any specific reason. They just kind of wake up one day and decide they want to do some volunteering. So there's something quite interesting about that, because they come from quite varied backgrounds, so you kind of get a lot of different types of people, so that's really interesting.
Have you noticed, is there a noticeable impact on the wider community?
We hope so. it's something that we look at quite a lot, the impact that we're making. It's something that is quite difficult to measure in what we're doing, because we're helping with education, and it's supporting people who might not otherwise be getting the support they need, but at the same time, they are also going to school, so they might be getting their education there. So it's kind of difficult to say what exactly we're doing if you kind of look at a community and say, oh, we made a huge difference there. but it's the kind of feel you get from it when you're at the sessions, watching the kind of involvement of the volunteers, the engagement the children are getting when they're really enjoying education. And I think that's something that's really important. I mean, I'm not going to pretend that they're loving every second of it, because they are sometimes sent there by their parents, and it's, they probably want to be home playing video games or something. But the times where you kind of catch some real spark between the volunteers and the children is, yeah, when I really feel like it, we're definitely doing something important here.
And do you feel that you've got to know the community better through this role?
Absolutely. I'll be honest that I kind of bought into some of the negative views of Bute Town before I started working there. I'd never really had much reason to go down there. And there are some really negative stereotypes of the area, that it's kind of dangerous to be in, that sort of thing. But having worked there, I've obviously got a lot more involved, especially with the children. I attend one of our sessions now each week in a kind of admin role, not in a teaching role. But it means you get to interact with the children on a week-to-week basis, you get to interact with the parents. There's sometimes a bit of a language barrier in that sense, but nonetheless, you're chucked right into the middle of the community, and you get to see there's some, you know, really lovely people there, and it's a perfectly safe place to be. And, you know, feel a little bit embarrassed about my attitude beforehand, but that's good. You know, it's kind of something that's opened my eyes to a different community, something that I really wasn't a part of before, and now happy to be involved in.
You mentioned the parents, so is there quite a lot of contact with them?
There's less than we'd like. We do try to make contact with the parents on a regular basis, for various reasons. One, for the sort of evaluation of our work. It's good to get feedback from the kids, but it's also good to get feedback from the parents to see that they feel like we're making a difference. But unfortunately, they, I don't know, for whatever reason, don't necessarily want to get involved with us. I mean, as I mentioned, there is an issue with a language barrier. A lot of the parents are from immigrant backgrounds, Somali, Yemeni backgrounds, and they don't necessarily speak English. Actually, one of our other projects is an ESOL project to attempt to teach English to the parents of the children from the learning clubs. But because they're not very confident in their speaking English abilities, they often don't want to interact with us, you know, because they're embarrassed or whatever. So if they turn up at the sessions, they'll often translate through the children, which is fine for sort of administrative reasons, but not brilliant for getting their feedback about the children, because I don't know, the children are probably, you know, translating that they're doing brilliantly in school. So we don't, you know, necessarily get quite the interaction that we'd like, but that's something we're always looking to improve on. So.
Are there other areas that the charity is looking to branch out into?
Well, again, it's something, the sort of the areas that we work in, is always something we're looking at, because we started out, I wasn't there at the time, I've only been there about 3 years, but the charity started out helping people who were struggling to find employment, and it was basically just helping them write CVs, helping with job interview prep and that sort of thing, and it has evolved since then. So obviously it's important that we do evolve, because we've quite dramatically changed what we do since then. We no longer really do anything employment based, it's important for us to kind of, I'm not necessarily branch out, but just kind of keep an eye on things that are needed in the community. The ESOL project came from, as I say, the parents of the children needing the help, but that project sort of disappeared for a little while because we didn't have the support to make it work. But we were continually getting phone calls from people saying, are you still running ESOL projects? Enough so that we eventually thought, well, you know, there's clearly a need for this. So we brought it back in, we looked how we can make it work, and we managed to get some funding, so now we're doing that again. So yeah, we're looking to evolve and make sure that we're providing services that are needed.
And what other projects are there other than the Learning Club and the ESOL project?
The main other one we have is a dementia project called Watch My Needs, which is about creating a sign language for people who are diagnosed with dementia. Because once the dementia progresses, they are unable to speak, or often unable to speak verbally. So the sign language helps them communicate with sign language using Makaton. And that's something that it's been shown that once they are no longer able to speak properly, they can still communicate. It's not that the mind is gone, it's that they're just not able to physically speak. So they're able to use sign language to communicate their needs, basically, because often it can be very simple problems, such as a pain somewhere that they can't communicate that they need sorted out, whereas if they have the sign language, they can continue to get their needs met. Just to say that, I think the other project that we're not really doing so much anymore was a project with elderly people in care homes, providing technology to them, and volunteers would go in and help them do things like email and Skype and that sort of thing, but that one's kind of faded away a little bit recently. So.
Is that because there's not necessarily the need for it anymore?
Well, what we found is that our role in it wasn't necessarily needed. It's still a great project,
yeah.
But basically what we found is that the volunteers were coming to us, we would send them to the care home, and that would be it. And what we found is actually they can just go straight to the care home. The care homes themselves do recruitment for that sort of thing, have volunteers go in and work with the residents. And really, I mean, the thing that we were providing, which was really helpful, was technology. Like, we would get some grants for iPads and computers. So we still have our equipment in some of the care homes around Cardiff, but we've kind of ceased our involvement so much with recruiting the volunteers because it's time consuming and they can already do it via the care homes.
Are there any frustrations or disappointments that you have while working in a charity?
There are lots of frustrations and disappointments. No, I mean, the biggest ones just come from the structural stuff, or the sort of administrative stuff. Funding is always an issue, and anyone who works in a charity knows about that, unless they're in a really big charity, but even then I'm sure it's an ongoing issue. We get bits of funding here and there, but there's always this struggle to kind of keep it consistent, keep in a situation where we feel comfortable that we can continue doing what we're doing. I think most of the frustrations would stem from that, in the sense that we don't always have the money to do the things that we want. All of the learning club, the children's project, is volunteer-led, but ideally we would actually like to pay some people in there. We have some incredible tutors who give up their time, and not just time in the session, but time outside of the sessions, who plan the sessions, prepare materials and all that sort of thing, and they give their own time for it, and we'd love to be able to say, look, you're doing more than as a volunteer's role. We'd like to be able to pay you a tutor fee, because that's what people would normally get paid for, that sort of work, you know. But unfortunately we don't have the money, so we're very lucky to have the volunteers who do that. But yeah, like, it's kind of, you know, you want to recognise someone doing incredible work. So
how would you define volunteering? What kind of roles do you think that would encompass?
Do you mean within the charity specifically?
I mean,
or?
This is a general question. I know it can be hard to think of on the spot.
Yeah, okay. Well, I mean, yeah, it's, I suppose, defining volunteering, it's I suppose it would mean different things for different people. I think if you ask one of the volunteers, they would talk about their experiences. So, I don't know. I mean, I think for me, because I was volunteering to begin with before I was volunteering in this role before I got it paid for it, but I was also volunteering in various other roles. For me, it was a way to get experience. It was a way to grow myself confidence-wise, while at the same time providing something in return for that. As a volunteer coordinator, I always kind of feel like it should be a two-way process. It's lovely when people just give up their time for absolutely no reason, but I still want to feel in that situation that they're getting something out of it, you know, even if it's just enjoyment. They feel like the community is improving because of them. So I feel like volunteering should be a situation where you have something to give, but you're also looking to build yourself in some way where it can be a mutually beneficial situation. Whether that be confidence or experience, which it often is in our case, or just giving some people a place to go. There have been situations with volunteers who, for whatever reason in their life, just don't have any anything to do during the day, or they're out of work and looking for work, but still unemployed, so they've got a lot of free time, and that can be really sort of depressing, basically, you know. So giving a volunteer somewhere to go, whether it be the learning club, or we sometimes have office volunteers who pop in and just do a bit of work in the office, but just so they have a weekly schedule and somewhere to go, I think that can be really important. People who are kind of in a emotionally quite low state, and giving them a boost to feel like they can do more with their lives.
So do you have any advice for current volunteers or people who are looking to volunteer in the future?
They're two separate things. A lot of advice for people who are looking and whether they should do it or not, do you mean?
Well, yeah, both, but you can do one first if you want.
Yeah, well, I mean, for people looking through it, I'd definitely say, I mean, I was thinking about it for a long time before I did it, mm-hmm. And in a weird way, it was quite a nerve-wracking experience because I was out of work at the time. So it's really just, you know, a lot of spare time on my hands, and it was quite daunting to walk in there and say, you know, I don't have a lot of work experience, I want to get more, but I don't really know what I want to do. It's basically just been up and up and up since then. You know, it's been a really positive experience and basically changed my life. So I can definitely say it's a good thing to do. I mean, I recognise that not everyone is going to be in the same situation as me, but I think if you feel an inkling that it could be something interesting to you, it's definitely worth giving a go, because there's probably something there you're looking to improve in your life, and there's quite likely a voluntary role that can help with that. So,
mm-hmm.
In terms of current volunteers, what would you mean advice in what sense?
I don't know, like anything you would say to encourage them, or maybe encourage them to take, say yes to more opportunities, or think about their development?
I would say, well, I'd say that you should be, as a volunteer, your kind of, the advice I would give to current volunteers as opposed to new volunteers is to be confident in what you want to get out of it. I suppose that applies to new volunteers as well, but like if you're already volunteering and you kind of feel like you've plateaued and the situation is, I don't know, getting boring, or you're not, feel like you're not contributing anymore, is to get more involved and ask for more roles, ask for more responsibility, because as someone who works in an environment with volunteers, there's always a role for people who are already there who want to do more. Incoming volunteers can be a bit different because you sort of don't know what their abilities are, you don't know their confidence level or what they're willing to do. But with current volunteers, you've already got a sense of them. So it can be a really great situation to be like, you know, having a volunteer come in and say, I want to do a bit more. And you're like, perfect, I know about you already. I know what your skills are. I know where you could fit into the charity in a greater role. So volunteers being communicative with whoever their sort of volunteer coordinator is, or whoever's in charge of handing out the roles, because we can't know necessarily if you're not happy with the situation unless you tell us. So feedback is really useful in that situation. So yeah, just being a bit more confident and just sort of saying, I want more to do, you know, if they want more to do.
Okay. And what's your best memory of when you were volunteering?
Best memory? I'm not sure if I could think of an individual one off the top of my head, but when I was volunteering with Radio Cardiff, well, it was with VCS and Radio Cardiff as the organiser for the radio show that VCS used to do.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, I suppose they still do it. I don't know. I think it might have recently finished, hasn't it? Cardiff in Action?
It's rebranding.
Rebranding, there we go. I knew something had happened with it recently. But I used to organise the guests for that, so I'd be in contact with a lot of different charities. And just meeting people each week from the charity who would come on the radio and talk about what they do. And it was really interesting every week just to get these different people from, again, lots of different backgrounds. I mean, they were working with a charity, so I suppose it was a common theme. But they're really varied. And actually, you know, thinking of one just off the top of my head, there was this guy who used to come in with one charity. I can't remember for the life of me which one it was because there were so many of them. But it was this volunteer who'd been volunteering with that charity for a long time, like 20 years or something like that. And every time he came, because we had charities on multiple times, every time he came in a really smart pinstripe suit. And it was just like, that's a great attitude, you know, like someone who's, you know, I'd like to believe that the radio is doing a good thing, but it was definitely not BBC or anything. So someone turning up looking really classy was really a nice thing to happen. You know, so that's really cool that that someone would make that effort to. I mean, maybe he did it all the time, but it's nice that he came along looking like that. So yeah, meeting very varied people at that role was a really nice experience.
So other than that role, have you had any other volunteering experiences?
The main bits have been with VCS and Radio Cardiff. I suppose Radio Cardiff is a voluntary role, although I feel that's more of a kind of a community involvement thing. I briefly volunteered at a charity called The Mentor Ring, who have connections to ACE, and that was sort of administrative stuff as well. They're a really good charity who do mentoring for various people, so it's again nice to be involved in something that felt like it was making a difference for people. And then of course I volunteered with ACE for about 18 months to 2 years before I was actually working there in various roles, going in there to begin with really not knowing much at all about like how an office worked or anything like that, so not necessarily being able to provide a lot, but you know, kind of chipping in here and there where they discovered that I was useful, which often tended to be IT related stuff. And then gradually building up my involvement as I got more familiar with what the charity did and understood how I could fit into it more, until eventually sort of taking on the role that I'm doing now, but in a more voluntary basis because there was no one around to do it, until eventually then some funding coming in able to pay me to do it. So really kind of working my way up. Again, that sounds a little bit like cynical in the sense of volunteering my way into a job, but that was never my intention. It was always just like, I want this experience, this is a really good charity, so I'm just going to stay here and, you know, while it's mutually beneficial, that thing again. But it just so happened that while I was there, it was some funding came in and I was able to get paid for it, which is really nice. So.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
You hinted at there being a difference between volunteering and community involvement. Do you want to elaborate?
Sure. I'm not sure there is a difference, to be honest, but it's just off the top of my head. It seems like a different experience. Volunteering in a charity and volunteering at Radio Cardiff, which up until recently was not technically a charity, it was just an organisation who had volunteers involved. It's a really good community, Radio Cardiff, so I don't want to sort of take away anything from it, but it was people sort of building something that they really liked, so like speaking on the radio or somehow being involved in the radio. I felt like that was more like people getting out of it than necessarily putting in, but that's not right either, because the community volunteers put together made up a great situation, but it just... there feels something slightly different in terms of the outcomes, I suppose. It wasn't necessarily helping anyone directly, that wasn't necessarily the aims of it, although it did, as a side product, help people like me who wanted to get experience, wanted to build confidence and meet new people. It was a great experience for me to be involved in it, and it achieved all those things. But I don't know if they necessarily have an aim to do that. It's a radio station, their aim is to broadcast music and that sort of thing. So. Although, as I'm saying that, they actually do have community engagement sort of remits, so I suppose, yeah. I don't know, it's a tricky one. In my head, I always kind of made them separate, but as I'm talking about it, I suppose, yeah, in a way, they're quite similar goals, really. So.
I think it's something that's an ongoing theme that we find in these interviews, that there are some people who lump those things together, and then there are other strictly defined.
Yeah.
In a way, what you're talking about with the radio sort of reminds me of more like maybe a university society, like radio show.
Yeah.
Where it's like kind of people coming together and, okay, they're not being paid for it, but they're kind of doing something they enjoy. It's almost like a hobby.
Yeah. I think this is it. That's a good word, is a hobby, because they kind of did feel something more about it that it's not necessarily using your skills, because I didn't have anyone if I first went there, but using your kind of enjoyment as the thing to carry you through it, rather than like the learning club for people coming along. The goal is to help children. If you get sort of that that experience or that place to be as a side product, that's really good and important, but there's like an end goal, whereas as you say, like a hobby seems to make sense for the radio, because everyone there loves radio and loves being involved in some way, whether it be on air or off air. So yeah, I think Yeah, because I definitely wouldn't say like you go along to the learning club as a hobby. It's definitely a thing you're looking to support people and also get something back from in the process of doing that. Yeah.
Have you found that your past volunteering roles have helped you in your role now, like working with volunteers?
Has it helped me?
Like the experiences?
Yeah, I mean, I think just in a general sense it's helped me because it gave me some confidence to speak to people. As I mentioned, that role of greeting and organising the interviews for VCS and Radio Cardiff, that was something I'd never done before, really, sort of interaction with people like that. So that built up my confidence to then speak to volunteers, which I have to do on a regular basis. I'm not really a huge people person, so having not exactly being forced to do that, but kind of dropping myself in a situation where I was needed, that built up my confidence, so that helped. I suppose being a volunteer myself gives me both sides of it. I think I like to think even if I dropped straight into this role, I wouldn't have ever been taken advantage of the volunteers, but being in the volunteer role, I guess I can appreciate that sort of, you know, you are there giving your own time, so you kind of reach a limit of, okay, I've done enough and I'm going to go home now, and that's perfectly fine because, you know, I'm not being paid to be here, and this is, as I say, needs to be a mutual thing. So as the volunteer coordinator, I'm always aware of that. So I suppose that's helped me to kind of give me both vantage points.
Do the volunteers interact much socially outside their volunteering role?
Not as much as I'd like. And that's my fault, to be honest. It's a tricky thing to do because there's quite a big bunch of volunteers. There's about 50 of our volunteers over the sort of various classes that we run. That includes the Learning Club, also the ESOL project that has volunteers involved. They don't actually do much, as far as I know, unless they're kind of arranging it themselves. We do organise socials from time to time, but the issue with that is it's really nice if a lot of people who are doing the same sort of thing get to know each other a bit more, but they do kind of need a bit of a catalyst to help that engagement between each other grow or make friendships or whatever. So we've had a couple of socials, and as I said, I'm not a big people person, but there hasn't been enough engagement like that. We found like the best things to do are do events, like doing events like bowling or something like that. But the problem with that is then they don't necessarily speak to each other because they're busy bowling or whatever. And so it's quite a difficult thing to get them together and then get them talking and opening up to each other and sharing experiences and sharing just little things about like where they live. Like, I was having a conversation with a couple of volunteers the other day who realised that they both live on the same street, and it was like one of them was driving home every time after the session, the other one was getting public transport. It's like, if we'd realised that, they could have just been giving lifts this whole time. So, we actually had, just last night, we had an event which was aimed to sort of help us decide the future of ACE, because we're always a little bit unclear about what we're doing, and we want more defined goals, basically. And that brought a lot of our volunteers together, and there was sort of unanimous agreement that we need to do more of that stuff because people really enjoyed hanging out and chatting to each other and getting to know each other. So we are going to try and do more of that, and I think it's something that is really important.
Have you got any ideas for how you're going to improve that?
Well, one idea did come up yesterday, which was to do a pub quiz, which I think actually that's a brilliant idea, and I don't know why I didn't think of it before, because it's a really good way of putting people in a group but giving them a kind of topic to talk about, so it's not just kind of, you know, awkward silences or difficulty, you know, thinking about what to discuss. And a regular event as well, pub quiz, like at the beginning of the month, every month, and then there's just a constant thing that they can go to, and I don't need to be organising everyone and trying finding a perfect day when they're all available. I can just be like, come along on the first Monday of the month, we'll be there every month, and that makes it a lot easier. So hopefully going to try and organise that.
Sounds like a good idea.
Yeah, I hope it works.
So do you feel like you've changed a lot due to the volunteering?
Yeah, I've definitely changed a lot. I don't know how other people would sort of come into the role, what their sort of experience is beforehand and what they're looking to gain. So you know, the difference it would make to a person could be a sort of big slope or just a gradual thing that's still important. But for me, I was coming from a place of, you know, for various reasons, not having worked for a little while, really not very confident and have very little work experience, and really looking to improve all the areas of my working life like that. And it's been life-changing, as I said, because I've come from not working, not having any confidence about dealing with people, to now being in a job where I'm getting paid to interact with people daily. And it's something that I still struggle with as a person who, as I say, isn't great necessarily speaking to people, but it's something that I've improved massively with. And it's not just within myself, I definitely feel it with myself, but people even like at ACE who have just known me for, like the recent trustees who've come in who just know me for about a year, so they can see it in me within the last year. So it's, well, I guess that's since I've been paid, but you know, it's a gradual rise that's included the payment period.
Do you see your volunteers developing as well?
Yeah, again, it differs depending on who the volunteer is, but you kind of see, for example, the development in the tutors who kind of come in without necessarily having any teaching experience before. They kind of drop into the role. Obviously, we monitor them to make sure that they're comfortable with it and doing okay, but you can see them kind of starting out to quite timid, a bit shy with class, till 6 months later when they're kind of walking in there and taking command of the class, and you see real differences in experiences in that sort of sense. Yeah, as I say, it differs per person. In how it can change. Sometimes it could be more subtle, just that sense of someone coming into the office perhaps to get experience with, just like I was basically, just getting experience being in an office in a working environment like that, and seeing them become more confident, able to take phone calls, that sort of thing. So yeah, constantly seeing differences in that sense.
And have you kept in touch with many of the people you've worked with over the years?
Yes, to some degrees. The funny thing about the third sector is that a lot of people bump into each other a lot of the time, even if you don't intend to. I mean, obviously, there are a lot of people I would intend to keep in contact with, but sometimes you just lose touch and then you bump into them again. Like, for example, Claudia is someone I chat to a lot when I was volunteering at VCS, but then we didn't chat for a long time, and then randomly bumped into each other in the street a couple of months back, and it was just like, oh, this is really nice, we should go for a coffee, we haven't seen each other in ages. So there are some people that I haven't kept in contact with, which I really should have done, you know. So and then there are other ones who I'm seeing on a sort of fairly regular basis, just for whatever reason. So for example, Jeremy, who runs VCS, obviously don't see him as much anymore, but I still bump into him now that VCS are based at Radio Cardiff. So that's really nice. And then Nathan Williams, who used to work at VCS, now works at a charity called Promo Cymru, and he was in our office the other day just giving us some advice about promotional stuff. So yeah, it's all quite linked, and it's really nice to see those familiar faces. You know, you kind of, it's not just a good networking thing, it's a nice kind of warm feeling of recognising someone that you've been working with before.
Do you have anything else that you'd like to talk about that maybe I haven't asked about, or anything you want to expand on?
I suppose nothing really that I haven't talked about, but just to reiterate that kind of idea of volunteering being something that can really add value to your life. It's something that I find a little bit frustrating when I'm talking to my friends, especially when I was volunteering. They would kind of dismiss it a bit as, and sort of saying, well, you're not getting paid for it, you know, almost like, what's the point of it? Which for me is, I don't know, I do appreciate it. People's time is valuable, so perhaps when they're not working, they want to be doing their own thing, spending time with friends and family and that sort of stuff. But I would like it if people got away from the idea of always needing monetary compensation for doing things. I know that's often the way our world works, but it's really nice to be involved in volunteering communities, and all the ones that I've been involved in, there's always been a great vibe with the people. You know, there's a nice interaction between the paid staff and the volunteers, and there's just a nice community feel to it. And whether you're on one side or the other, it doesn't need to be something where you're going in getting paid for it. You know, you can get lots out of it in other ways. And I think it just, you know, just if it sounds really cheesy, but it just makes the world a better place, you know, because if people only do things when they get paid for it, it means there's a lot less opportunities for these sort of communities to evolve and grow. So I think it'd be nice if people looked past that a little bit and actually, you know, gave a shot to doing something different, even if it's not something they would imagine getting something out of initially, you know, just give it a try. So, yeah.
A few questions. Okay, well, thank you for your time.
No problem.
It was lovely to speak to you.
It's been a pleasure.